Good afternoon. So I have the honor of presiding over the last session of the day and to introduce a fantastic panel, both in person here and virtually. So I'm Leana Wen. I'm a columnist with the Washington Post and a professor at George Washington University. And I will be moderating this very distinguished panel of five people. I know that we've talked about this throughout the day of how we have many wonderful panelists on each panel, and they know to do this in TV style comments in terms of length of responses. But what I'm gonna do is to introduce briefly our distinguished panelists. I'll introduce them in turn and then ask them for their opening remarks on working across agencies to address reforms to global health security infrastructure. I would like them to touch upon the importance of doing so, best practices, and also to consider, as we have been throughout today, about how COVID has changed the landscape in terms of changing or in terms of changing or not our thoughts about this necessary reform. So I'm first going to start with Dr. Paul Friedrichs, who is the director of the Office of Pandemic Preparedness in the White House. Dr. Friedrichs.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Wen, and thanks to all of you for the opportunity to be here. I'm sorry I couldn't attend the morning session. I'll start by saying that it is an incredible privilege not only to be here today, but to be serving in this role as the inaugural director for this office, intended to be the integrating function across the many federal agencies involved in both domestic and global pandemic preparedness and response. And for those of you who are familiar with the genesis of this, this was a bipartisan effort within Congress, recognizing that one of the areas in which many people felt our country had an opportunity for improvement was how we integrated that domestic and global response, and then how we brought the lessons from the global community back into what we were doing domestically or vice versa. So it's a tremendous honor to serve in this role. We're building out our team, and I see a few familiar faces in the audience here who are helping with us. And we look forward to partnering with each of you, because the biggest thing that we're trying to bring forward with this team is the sense that, as difficult as COVID was, to your point, where we succeeded, it was together. Where we struggled, it was when we did not partner well. And so we're eager to partner with you and learn from the comments shared here today.
Thank you so much. And next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Lester Martinez-Lopez, who is the Assistant Secretary for Health Affairs in the U.S. Department of Defense.
Again, good afternoon. Thank you for having me. I think when we look at health preparedness and readiness to react, every agency of the government brings a different set of capabilities. The Department of Defense have shown that many, many times. The Department of Health and Human Services, all the agencies bring different sets, the Department of State. So the issue is, how do we best work together? And then I have the opportunity to work on international disaster relief, and how do we work at the interagency? How do we work with the NGOs in such a way that we bring the best to the table, and we execute in a way that we best serve the people we mean to serve? So I think I'm looking forward to this young man's leadership to really bring all of us to the table and help us achieve our best so we can serve the country and our friends and partners the best.
Excellent, thank you. And our last in-person panelist here is Nidhi Bouri, who is the Deputy Assistant Administrator for Global Health and USAID. Welcome.
Thanks so much. I'll just echo actually one thing that Lester just said, which is each of our agencies are just one piece of the pie. We're each a tool in the US government's toolbox. So at USAID, as the lead development agency for the US government, the global health portfolio is about $8 billion in investment from USAID every year, $900 million of which is in global health security, which I know because that's our fastest growing portfolio within the global health program. And a lot of what we look at is both vertical investments, such as our investments as an implementer of PEPFAR or in the space of malaria or tuberculosis, but also cross-cutting at health system strengthening and how we can drive earlier and more robust investments in primary healthcare, but in other aspects of health system capacity, and what role that has ultimately to support partner nations and regions and preparedness for different types of health threats. But then we also work on the response side and across the spectrum that's done hand in glove with other agencies, because what we look at is where our investments play to the strengths of our agency and where our partners at State Department or CDC or DRD or others may leverage the skills and tools that they have. But collectively, I think where this comes, where the rubber meets the road for a kind of reform of the international system is we collectively look at the evidence and the lessons that we've learned from investments across the world, and particularly in response to different threats, whether that's COVID, but also Mpox or Ebola, and looking at how we collectively can help influence the international system to be fit for purpose with a lens on future threats and future needs. And so that's really, I think, the effort that we've worked together, whether it's with State and OGA through their different engagements, looking at high-level partnerships and the institutional relationships with international organizations, but also looking at the engagements we have at the national level with governments.
Thank you. And next, I would like to introduce Dr. Mandy Cohen, who is the director of the Centers for Disease Control Prevention, virtually, joining us virtually.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, terrific. Well, I'm sorry I'm not there in person, but thanks for the opportunity to just share a few words today. I think the CDC does incredible work around the globe, 60 countries, 400 plus diseases, health risk conditions that are major causes of death, disease, and disability. And it is just incredible to work side by side with some of the world's leading scientists and technical experts in epidemiology, in biodetection, in informatics, lab systems, and other disciplines. And I think CDC really is on the ground helping so many countries fulfill what they need to do in terms of building a strong public health infrastructure for their country. So CDC staff is on the ground every day working with countries and partnering with them to train disease detectives and emergency responders, to improve the lab capabilities, to help innovate, whether it's to fight HIV, TB, to immunize children, and importantly, to implement and help countries stand up their own national public health institutes that are modeled after the CDC. So very much a partnership. And as others have echoed already, that CDC is one of a number of ways in which the US government partners together to think about global health security and to partner with countries. There's been a number of ways, and whether it's health work groups or others that have brought different parts and different strengths across the US government together in service of health promotion and health strengthening for individual countries. I think importantly, CDC brings the opportunity to be close to the ground and make sure that we are adapting the science to the individual needs of communities. And that is where each one of us across the government can play different roles as we partner together. I wanted to say USAID and CDC have been partners for quite a long time, and Atul Gawande and myself have really made sure to continue what he started with Rochelle Walensky before me, to really make sure that we're not just sharing information across the government, but actually planning together as we support folks around the world. Thanks.
Thanks very much. And last but not least, our final panelist for these opening remarks is Loyce Pace, the Assistant Secretary for Global Affairs in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Welcome.
Hi, Leana. Hi, friends on stage and in the room. I apologize I can't be with you all as well. I'm with our partners here in the EU. But I'll just bring up the rear by saying our Office of Global Affairs is just really happy to be a part of this panel, obviously, and be teaming up with the new bureau and under Ambassador Nkengasong's leadership. So congrats again to him and his team. You know, our office as well, it's funny, was established back in 1945 at the request of State Department, I learned. And so at the time, they were saying, look, we really need the Department of Health to be our spokesperson and representative in the world when it comes to these major health issues and priorities. I think at the time we were trying to tackle yellow fever and a range of other issues that came down the pike since then. So everything from infectious diseases to now NCDs and even climate change and other issues really fall under our purview when it comes to how we liaise with health actors. But as everyone's saying, we couldn't do that without the support of others across the department and across the USG. So just speaking of HHS, you have Mandy here from CDC, But importantly, we have our FDA, NIH, and other shops like our Administration for Strategic Preparedness and Response. We have our Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Agency. We have our Office for Civil Rights and Indian Health Service. All these agencies really not only have a lot to share with partners around the world, but frankly, a lot to learn from partners around the world. So the job we play and the role we play at OGA on behalf of HHS and USG is to try to bring those lessons home and ensure that we are learning not only for, say, pandemic preparedness and response, but also for maternal and newborn and child health, right? Look at their mortality rates in this country for Black and Brown women as an example of that. I think beyond this sort of agency to agency or more bilateral approach, we really are looking at global policy work. And so whether we're leading delegations to the World Health Assembly or trying to negotiate agreements and amendments or otherwise working with G7, G20, at the regional level, we're working with APEC, OECD and the like. And so, of course, that's not just about HHS and what we're able to do, but how we're able to bring the power of USG to bear in those settings. And so it's just really, I think, a strong showing of how we collaborate. And just to bring it back full circle, one thing we really learned from state is the power of health diplomacy. And so we get to have a handful of health attaches all around the world, whether that's China and India or Mexico and Brazil, who themselves are really on the ground and leading the way in terms of our health policy and partnerships.
Thank you very much. I learned a lot from your framing remarks in terms of the work that all of your agencies do and in collaboration with one another. So thank you for that. Building on that, Nidhi, if I can begin with you, can you tell us an example of a good collaboration in your experience between health, development, and diplomacy that you've been a part of?
Sure. There are many examples, so it's not that this is the only example, and I'll do one that's not COVID, but a more recent example, last year, the USG really came together, a lot of our agencies here on the screen in the room, to support the government of Uganda in response to the Sudan Ebola virus outbreak, which I have to say within just 3 months with no approved countermeasure used in that response came to an end, which is pretty incredible. And I think the reason I note it is it's an example of the type of coordination that has happened for years, but because we've improved how we work together and the way we pull resources together, it really speaks to how we support countries hit that endpoint of an outbreak much faster. So in this outbreak, we at USAID had worked with our colleagues at HHS, at CDC, DOD, and state to really look at all the different types of interventions that were needed for that response, whether it was case management, infection prevention and control, community engagement. And centered in all of that, obviously, was the need to engage the government. And our colleagues at State Department through the embassy and the chief of mission there were really instrumental in opening up some of those channels so that us at USAID, but also our colleagues at CDC, both of whom have very close operational ties, could do our work a little faster and have some connections into parts of the government where perhaps that went beyond the typical channels of engagement that we had. But then at the same time, we also had a real risk for spread or concern around travel. And so it spoke to the need to get to that endpoint of an outbreak much faster. So we again kind of leveraged that diplomacy channel with our colleagues at State Department, not just here at headquarters, but particularly through the embassy, to work with the government and also to open up channels for other governments and other types of donors who traditionally provide investment and support to all mobilize our resources a bit faster. So I think it ultimately speaks to, I think, the reason why we need the power of partnership across the USG, not just for the resources that the USG brings to bear, but how we in turn can help influence and leverage other types of partnerships that go beyond governments. A lot of times in international organizations, other types of financial investment, but also resource mobilization, but all of which is centered in supporting a host nation in reaching a certain outcome. And we do that a lot on the preparedness and prevention side too. It's the part that people don't see as much, but those relationships just come out a lot more, I'd say, in response.
Thank you. Mandy, if I can turn to you next. I understand that you and your team just traveled to Brazil and that this was your first international trip as CDC director. Can you tell us about what you experienced, what you learned, and in particular when it comes to interagency coordination and health security?
Sure. Well, yes, my first international trip as CDC director, and it was a special trip because actually Assistant Secretary Pace and I traveled together. So she and the Minister of Health in Brazil were co-hosting a forum there. And I got to participate in that. So again, showing the collaboration, and it allowed actually for me to see the CDC work, but also to understand the work across HHS. So we actually toured together one of the manufacturing facilities for vaccines. FDA obviously has a big role in the vaccine regulatory space, and then CDC on the recommendations and the execution, right? So it was a great way to think about, again, that holistic partnership. I'd say the other part that came through loud and clear was the importance of data exchange and making sure that data exchange could be rapid and fast. And I think that's where CDC brings a lot of expertise. We brought a number of data experts with us on that trip to start to facilitate a conversation about data exchange within Brazil, but also across all South America. So that was exciting. And then the last, we're seeing a lot of countries, you know, as we come out of the pandemic, make larger investments in their public health infrastructure, which is fantastic. So for example, Brazil is making a $2 billion investment in their lab infrastructure and capability. And we had the opportunity to share some lessons learned from our side as we built up some of our lab capability. And we look forward to ongoing technical assistance and ways we can partner and learn from them as they are building the newest investments in lab.
Sounds like a terrific trip. Thank you for sharing with us. Paul, you had mentioned a bit about how you're thinking about your new office. And I wonder, how do you consider the domestic versus international component of the work? And also, how do you think about COVID in relation to all the other potential new pathogens that we'll be encountering?
Yeah, so the, you know, for those of you who have read the National Biodefense Strategy, you know that we bucket the threats in three big bins. There are the naturally occurring threats like COVID, and there's a lot that we've learned from that, and a host of other naturally occurring threats that we should be preparing for. And so one of the things that our office is involved in is looking across the federal government and with academic and international partners to understand who's doing what to develop the lab capabilities that Dr. Cohen was talking about so we can better detect future outbreaks. Who's doing what to develop medical countermeasures or new personal protective equipment or other capabilities so that we can contain an outbreak before it becomes a pandemic rather than respond to an outbreak after it becomes a global event. Then we have the accidental biological events that are well described in the biodefense strategy. And as we look at the explosion, the number of BSL 3 and 4 labs around the world and the number of people who rightfully are trying to do research in this area to protect their local or regional population, we recognize that there are opportunities to partner with them, just as the CDC and other parts of the US government does, to help build that safe and appropriate environment in which to do those research efforts that are very important at the national and the regional level. And then lastly, we have to acknowledge that we're at an inflection point in the practice of medicine today. If you look at the confluence of artificial intelligence, biotechnology, nanotechnology, it is not far-fetched to say that the practice of medicine is changing at a pace that we literally have not seen since the antibiotic era began, if not faster. And that creates the tremendous potential for good things to happen in the next 5 to 10 years. And also the tremendous peril for those people in the world who want to misuse that technology to do so in a way that undermines the health security of countries around the world, undermines the global economy, and undermines the safety of individual families and workplaces. So a big part of what we're focusing on is how do we knit all of that together? We've got tremendous investments that we're making, tremendous efforts, not only in the United States government, but with allies and partners in all of those areas. But often we find that they're very similar. Instead of being complementary, they're even competitive. How can we help to build a more balanced portfolio that mitigates as many of those risks as possible at the global level, bring back the best practices domestically, so that we are all better prepared and, more importantly, more resilient when the next pandemic occurs? And the last thought that I'll share on that, even if we do all of that right, even if we have a perfect vaccine, we have flawless tests, we will struggle with biological outbreaks because we have a remarkable information environment right now in which many people no longer believe the formerly credible sources of information that they once turned to. Part of why events like this are so important and why I applaud CFR and Ambassador Nkengasong and his team for putting this together, we will fail if we continue to speak with mixed messages from different parts of the federal government, or mixed messages between the federal and state government, or mixed messages between industry and government, or mixed messages between the United States and the EU, the African CDC, or other credible voices. When moms and dads are trying to figure out who to listen to, it complicates that decision if there's four different answers to one question. And so what I would ask each of you to help with, and what our office is particularly pledged to do, is to partner with those who are willing so that we have consistent, credible communication that families, employers, government officials, and others can turn to when they're trying to make an informed decision. But that will take a partnership across not just the US government, but around the world.
To be sure, misinformation, disinformation has had a very significant toll. So thank you for also addressing that point. Lester, people may not always think of the DoD and the in terms of the work with global health, but there's a lot that the DoD does. And can you give us some examples of that?
Well, typically when you think of lab network around the world, you think of CDC. Well, we do have a network of labs around the world. They're doing research for the Department of Defense. Our main concern is that the health of our service members is kept, right? So they're gonna be exposed to many things, malaria, dengue. And in response to that, the Department of Defense for many, many years, hundreds of years, right? So it's been involved into from Walter Reed, Gorgas on yellow fever to right now in the world, all the drugs, I don't know if it's still it's true, all the drugs against malaria, all but two were DoD discoveries. Or HIV work, the same thing, seminal work, because we're concerned for our service members. We're looking for solution sets for them. But when we find those solution sets, we don't keep it to ourselves. We give it to the world, right? So health security for the forces of the United States translate into health security for the people of the world, if you think about that. And that's kind of how we deal with the investment. On top of that, you know, I'll give you another example. When PEPFAR came about, the first site PEPFAR deployed was Kericho, Kenya. It was Kericho, Kenya, because we had a lab in Kericho, Kenya, doing with HIV. We were working the vaccine, trying to set up a place where we could test that vaccine. And we had the whole infrastructure to be able to deploy PEPFAR right on the spot. So we were taking care of the population. We were doing all that. So we partnered and we made it happen. Still today, we are in Africa, link up with all their military ministers of defense. And we're taking care of that part of the PEPFAR exercise. And along the world, I mean, that's PEPFAR is not just, it's one of many examples of how the Department of Defense engaged in diplomacy, engaged in the actual development of security measures that are deliverable to the world. And that we're very proud of and we take extremely serious. I have personally been in Kenya. I've been personally been in Peru. I've been personally been in Thailand. I've seen those labs. And if you want to see missionaries, go visit with those people that are serving the Department of Defense in places that you never dream of. And they're doing God's work. And true, even though they work for the Department of Defense, even though those solutions are geared to take care of the service members, they know that they're also doing it for the world. And by doing that, we win-win. The other part of the Department of Defense, probably you remember from COVID, we're very good at logistics. We're very good at developing science. We're very good at that, those kind of developing products. By the way, I brag, one of the first mRNA applications of a vaccine, I was a commander of Fort Detrick in those days. We funded the Navy to start developing an mRNA vaccine against malaria. Didn't pan out, but that was one of the seminal works to start working that platform against as a vaccine platform. So I guess I'm bragging a little bit. I need to brag because I'm extremely proud of the work the department does on behalf, not just of the service members that we're bound to serve, but also on behalf of the world. So those are, I hope that that sprinkle of example gives an idea of why we're in the game and what do we do for a living.
Absolutely. The examples, I think, are illustrative and help us to gain a better understanding. Loyce, can you talk to us about how HHS coordinates the various needs associated with vast and complex agendas of multilateral health bodies like the WHO?
Sure. Well, I mentioned in passing some of the negotiations taking place at WHO, like with the pandemic accord or agreements, international agreement, and these international health regulations and how we want to improve those. Look, I think you and Paul were talking at the beginning about the lessons we've learned from COVID, and there were some bright spots. Obviously, there, you know, was scientific cooperation, there was global surveillance. Those things, you know, did work in large part. And yet there's a sense of failure around the world with regards to the access that they had to those innovations, the very innovations that, that Lester was just talking about, right? So it's great that we can celebrate these things, and yet where did they go and how were they used and how did they help not just people around the world, but Americans because of how they were distributed? When we think about access to these innovations, of course, it's the right thing to do, but it's also the smart thing to do. We know that there were various variants that popped up around the world, and in large part because we weren't able to vaccinate in time to keep up with the evolution or emergence of those variants. And so I still remember, you know, being on the COVID board end of 2020 and really being doggedly focused on how we could push for access from day one in this administration. And it's still a feather in our cap to have distributed the vaccines that we did, again, as a U.S. government around the world. And we know that it wasn't enough for the U.S. to do that alone in the way that we did. And while other countries pitched in, there was still more that needed to happen for us to really get ahead or stay ahead of the virus. And so that's a big lesson learned that we're trying to apply in these negotiations. And importantly, it's really going to take all of us and not just the USG getting ready to either share or spend or otherwise help with scaling, but other countries coming to the table too, which they are, which is a good thing. The last thing though I'll say about that is it's not just about charity, and that's just really an important point for us to keep in mind, and that's constantly driven home in our discussions. You know, countries, governments themselves really want to be providing for their citizens in ways that they feel are meaningful and effective and aren't reliant on donations, right? Because it's not necessarily the case that those will come through all of the time. And so it's one of the reasons why we're also really focused on ways that we can assist with manufacturing, otherwise providing technical assistance, if not investments. And so I'm sure others have talked about that throughout the day. You know, obviously there are ways that HHS and our various agencies are able to work with other parts of USG to help make that happen. But the bottom line is it's not a zero sum game, right? It's not we help us or we help them. We really have to keep in mind that our fates are inextricably linked, and there's really no health security without health equity. It's not a nice thing to have, right? It's not a nice thing to do. It's essential to our work. And I think you've heard everyone from the president on down really, really make that case.
So the final question for all of our panelists, and Loyce, I'm going to start with you and go backwards through our panel this time. And the final question is, now that we have heard so much about what different agencies do and examples of what's worked, can you help us to look forward and say, how can we better integrate health into foreign policy goals and structures and vice versa? And what more can be done to promote interagency collaboration? Loyce?
I think remembering why we're all here is something that I start with every day. And I just really want to applaud and thank my colleagues, the ones I can see, but even the ones that I can't, who I think every day show up and say, look, what good do we want to be and do in the world? And how and who can I show up with to make that happen? I think that's probably my answer to the second question too, right? There's, you know, a little bit of angst and anxiety about the fusion of foreign policy and health in some circles, right? There's some purists out there in the health space who say, oh my goodness, we don't want to politicize what we do. And yet, of course, that is often the case. And yet we want to take the good, right? And we want to ensure that we're able to elevate the work that we do. There's so much work to be done and there's so much to go around. And I'd love help, frankly. So I think that keeping that in mind is the way that we can move forward.
Thank you so much. And Mandy, to you next.
Sure. Well, I'll talk about the work I think we are doing at CDC first to be better integrated as one CDC team. Oftentimes, we have experts in TB or malaria or infectious, respiratory diseases or Ebola. And we need to make sure that we can bring that expertise together and speak with one voice so that when we are interacting with a country and understanding their needs, they don't have to wade through the bureaucracy of either CDC or the USG. And so we are doing some important work within CDC, both to make sure we have the support we need at the country level, but to integrate as one team. And I think that we need to go beyond just, as I was mentioning before, beyond just sharing information across what each of us are doing in the government to actually planning together to say, here's what we're going to do here. So either we have shared expertise in this place, so we'll do it in different geographies, or to say we have different expertise and here's how we have to layer these together, because it does take all of these different kinds of discipline in order to be truly good partners on the ground to some of our folks. So I think there's some work we CDC are doing internally, some work I think needs to be done across USG again to be better partners and be more integrated.
I'll turn to you next.
Sure, thanks. So I would say, especially for USAID's perspective as an agency that looks at health as part of our broader development priorities, investments in health don't just pay dividends for health. I mean, and that's because they pay dividends for human development. Essentially, when we invest in people, not just to ensure that they're healthy, those are also people who can go on to be contributing members of their economies in areas that might have some element of fragility. It's essentially assuring that people have access to the most basic needs. And so we do see very clear ties in every part of the world to the health and well-being of people, to the broader health and well-being of communities. And I think for that reason, we really look at how we leverage our investments, particularly in an increasingly challenging resource environment where while we have immense resources at USAID, they're of course, like all of our interagency partners, they're limited. And so I think to speak to some of the points that were made earlier, we really are trying to be quite thoughtful about where USAID's comparative advantage can go the furthest. And a lot of that is aligning our resources to invest in certain areas that complement part of a holistic US government approach so that we collectively can make more impact with the investments we make. But it also speaks to the way that we are refreshing how we're looking at partnerships that go well beyond the US government. And there are all types of resources that go well beyond financial that other partners really bring to the table. And I think particularly as we look at a development agenda in the next 5 to 10 years, not even looking so much beyond that, ensuring that that agenda is set by the partners who we are trying to support, that we are being responsive to that, and that we are helping not just innovate, but bring innovations to scale and bringing different types of interventions to scale in a way that address health needs before they become real challenges for communities.
Thank you, Lester.
I think for chief global health security from my vintage, it takes a village. The good ideas not necessarily will come from the States. They may come from abroad. We need to be mining and be understanding of that. So we're ready to accept those ideas and incorporate them into this, the set that is going to give us a solution set to take care of our patients, right? That's how I approach this. We have a lot of international agreements in biosurveillance, by the way. We have a big, all healthcare systems have to have a surveillance system. That's key to delivering healthcare. That's not unique to the CDC. We have our own. The question is, do we link up, right? And an example of an idea, how do we link up? Airbans are going all over the world. And if they come with a respiratory infection, we swab them year round. Thousands and thousands of those samples are tested for see if there's a flu. And those data are fed to the CDC, and the CDC then use that data point, those data points, to figure out what will be the next year flu vaccine makeup, right? So we need to really leverage what we all bring to the equation, whether it's research, whether it's surveillance, whether it's care, whether it's new solution sets, doesn't care. It doesn't matter. It could be from here. It could be from abroad. Quite often we think we're giving. Nope. We need to think we're also taking. So what if we go and do cost surveillance to the country, we share with them and they share with us. And then we share with the international community and we share with the government of the United States, with the CDC and everything else. We don't just keep it to ourselves and go, that would be absolutely crazy, because it work against what we're trying to achieve when it comes out to security. So I think as long as we understand that we don't own all, that we're not the smartest kids in the block, that there's a lot of other smart kids around, I think we'll have a better chance to succeed.
Thank you. And Paul, you have the last word.
Well, thank you. And again, I'll just say thanks to the Council for Foreign Relations and Council on Foreign Relations and Ambassador Nkengasong for putting this together. And I'll end with a couple of thoughts. First, 1918, the worst pandemic in nearly a millennia, began right here in the United States. So when we talk about giving and receiving, that was a case in which we gave in a way that we would hope we would never do again. And we learned from those overseas in how to mitigate the impacts of that pandemic. If you look at what happened after that pandemic, there were people who committed the rest of their lives to trying to leverage the lessons learned from that pandemic. The whole field of virology grew out of that pandemic because of the disagreements within the medical and the political community over what caused that pandemic. And people spent decades trying to learn from that, partnering around the world, sharing data so that we could understand that it was not just bacteria that existed in the world around us, but there were also viruses. And if you wanted to mitigate a biological threat, you had to be prepared for both. So the challenge for all of us in this room is, how do we make that same commitment that our predecessors did 100 years ago to partner, to continue to look for the answers that will come out of this pandemic, to partner with those around the world who are looking at this and seeking to learn from it, so that collectively, 20 years from now, we can look back on this and say, as horrific as the COVID pandemic was, it opened the door to great discoveries that have profoundly improved our ability to protect the health of people around the world. To Loyce's point about equity, this can't just be about people in New York or in New Orleans. It's gotta be about people in every country, in every village around the world, because all of us who work in this space understand that the next outbreak can happen anywhere, including here. And so whatever advances we make have to be advances that we are willing to share, and that we then test and refine with our partners around the world. And the last thought that I'll leave with you is the one that I said before. The most powerful thing that we can do is recommit to regaining the trust of people around the world. Whatever else people do, that's their business. But those of us who have committed to global health security, those of us who have spent our careers trying to help those when they needed healthcare, or when they wanted to preserve the health of their unborn child or of their grandparent, know that the great value that we bring is credible, consistent communication that informs the decision that a mother makes about what to do for her child, that a son makes about what to do for his parent, that an employer makes about what to do for their workforce. We can no longer allow ourselves to be divided by those who want to pick apart our answers. We really have the opportunity to recommit that the greatest good to national security and to global health security is to speak with one voice about what we know and what we don't know.
Thank you so much. And I hope that you will all join me in thanking our distinguished panelists and CFR as we welcome. Thank you. We're thrilled to now welcome Ambassador John Nkengasong for your closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. What a symposium, what a fascinating symposium. And I'll try not to summarize the symposium. I think that will be tasking myself in a manner that is not acceptable. I think we've all had a lively and engaging conversation. We started off with a promise that this was going to be rich and this was going to be valuable. And I'm sure it has been rich, it has been valuable. When Secretary Blinken launched the Bureau on August the 1st, he said something you've said many times. He said, global health security is national security. Global health security is national security. And he stated he charged us with three goals. One was to elevate global health security as part of foreign policy. Second, to coordinate by leading with diplomacy all our assets, and lastly, to leverage our assets as much as possible. We've heard today in a remarkable way how that has all come to alignment. Let me repeat some of what, or share what I thought I heard today. I heard the power of partnerships all across the board, the need to coordinate our efforts. And that brings me to what Paul just said a few minutes ago, and thanks. Maybe you heard me saying Paul, then he was coming in from the other side. Paul, in your words, you said, we will fail if we continue to speak with mixed messages, end of quote. I think that summarizes this meeting. Secretary Blinken the other day raised a notion, a thinking or a concept called diplomacy variable geometry, which essentially says, in this critical period where we face multiple challenges, we need to identify what the problem is, identify the right partnerships, inform and shape, and try to use that in solving the problem. Which means we must coordinate our efforts, cooperate, collaborate, and communicate. We've heard a lot about communication here, including AI, the use of data diplomacy, so that it's evidence-based. We've heard about partnership with the private sector and foundations, the panel that was moderated by Dr. Adam brought that to the fore. We heard from Professor Orama how the bank in Africa leveraged about $2 billion in supporting a health security threat. So I will not try to, again, go past that, but rather to say that there are five things that the Bureau will try to do. One is to finish the fight against HIV/AIDS, which is to get PEPFAR reauthorized. And you heard those voices loud and clear, including and starting with Dr. Fauci. Second is to make sure that we transform the structures that were put in place during the COVID response, the foreign ministry platform called GAP, into a global health security platform. Thirdly is to ensure that we coordinate, promote the coordination, the spirit of global health variable diplomacy, which is coordination and cooperation. Fourthly, to strengthen the global health security architecture, including the pandemic fund, which I have been honored to join the board now, representing the State Department and the Pandemic Accord. And lastly, global health diplomacy. I think when we see what happened with the Ebola outbreak or the Marburg outbreak in Equatorial Guinea, it brought home the whole concept of what we're trying to do here, which is essentially get the State Department, our embassies that are out there in the field to lead where we have the gaps and bring all the agencies together. Equatorial Guinea set that example where there was no agency, US agency in country. The US ambassador there was outstanding. Engaged with the government of the country, engaged with WHO and facilitated everybody else to come in from the US side to leverage the resources. That's what we'll continue to see in with disease outbreaks and health security. We just don't know when the next outbreak will happen. We always thought that a disease threat will emerge from maybe the jungle of DRC or Cameroon and then spread all over the world. This time around, those viruses came from the airports and spread into the remote areas. So we just don't know where that threat will come from. So with all of that, I just want to thank a couple of people, the staff, the Global Health Security Bureau staff that had been working very, very hard. I would like them to stand up, please. If you can, George, and all of you who have been, Hillary, if you are here, please stand up and be acknowledged. Yes. George is here, he's hiding behind you. CFR, thank you for your partnership. If they are still here, okay. Thank you so much for feeding us lovely food. And those who have traveled far, I mean, I can see our colleague from the Pasteur Institute here, Dr. Sal, the Africa CDC delegation is here, Dr. Edem from the Afro Champions, and others who have truly traveled far from, and Peter Otis, thank you. We met in Chicago and I over at dinner, and I said, Peter, please, you really have to come and tell the story. And thank you for coming all the way, and many others. So let me just also acknowledge our agencies, the different agencies that were on the last panel. Without them, we would probably not have, or truly not have, a global health security coordination within the US government. So thank you all for being willing to work with all of us. We will use the comments that you've provided to complete a 5-year strategic plan, which we'll make public. The 5-year strategic plan for the Bureau, which will capture all the suggestions, the wisdom that you've all impacted on all of us. So let me then wish you safe travels. Those who have traveled far, or those who just drove across the street, but thank you so much. And this will be an annual event that the Secretary himself, who actually wanted to be here today, but because of many things happening in the world, he's not been able to attend. So thank you all.